Tom Rosano, and I'm toxicologist and director of the National Toxicology Center at the Center for Medical Science. I'm also professor of laboratory medicine at the Albany Medical Center Hospital and College. Here at the National Toxicology Center, we have a caseload of about 10,000 cases per year. In my experience in postmortem toxicology, there would be less volume, less than 1,000 cases per year. And in postmortem, my answer to the questions that might be raised as to how much do you use mass spectrometry is that it's used 100%. All cases are evaluated by mass spec. In the area of court-related testing and chemical dependency and others, there is less of a use in practice for the mass spectrometry, and it uses the paradigm that has been used for a very long time, which is really to screen by presumptive methods, and to the extent that you find a positive by those screening methods, to go on and then use the more definitive and mass spec confirmatory methods. We have moved away from that. I would say that at the present time, more than 80% of our caseload has immunoassay testing replaced by definitive testing. Definitive drug analysis really can be defined as a selective identification of drugs and their metabolites. I add to that particular definition myself that selective identification needs a level of certainty that allows for molecular information. I translate that by saying, therefore, it really is chromatographic separation and interfaced with mass spectrometry that allows for molecular information. And the more information that we gain about the molecular species, the more we become certain as to the determination that is being made. So definitive testing really needs to have the components of selective identification and molecular information in that particular approach to definitive testing. We've changed the paradigm from what has been a relatively non-selective testing done by a presumptive method, which gives a positive for something present, maybe something in a class of drugs that's present, to then a definitive confirmatory testing. What we've done is replaced the presumptive by definitive, because we think there are clear advantages associated with upfront initial definitive testing. In current toxicology practice today, there are limitations of presumptive testing by, for example, for immunoassay. And they relate to the lack of selectivity of those methodologies. They relate to the detection limits that are currently used in those presumptive assays. And it also relates to the adaptability of presumptive testing and immunoassay and the development of antibodies and epitopes on the ever-increasing number of new agents that are out there. Those areas of deficiency where we only know that it's an opiate positive really is limiting the ability to understand what agents are really on board. And again, because of the lack of selectivity, may be limiting our ability to know the metabolites that are there and a great deal of information that is now quite interpretive in terms of what drug is on board and information about that drug and the use of that drug by that individual. Mass spec, definitive methods are really necessary in this day and age to really respond to the needs and the diversity of drugs that are out there. And our ability also to lower the thresholds for detection of these agents as we have various agents that are very low dose and low circulating levels and low excretion levels of those agents. And there's also a significant number of agents that are not covered by the testing that is available by presumptive methodology, and we're missing those agents and not reporting those agents in our practice if we're using those methodologies. We've looked at the rate of false negatives, and it's an important point to make in terms of the use of presumptive testing. Because of thresholds, being high because of the fact that certain classes of drugs are not being measured, there is a false negative rate that is significant. For example, if you look at a population and you do broad-based definitive screening, you will find that some of the highest frequency drugs are drugs that we're currently not including in our presumptive. The gabapentinoids, for example, are those particular agents. And a number of agents that are on our streets now, mitrogenin, a whole host of agents that are really not being detected in those particular tests. False positives is another area that's important. We have a zero tolerance for false positives. It's a forensic tenet the reporting of an agent that is not present as a false positive. So the level of certainty that we need is certainly high in terms of our confidence in those results, in terms of sending out those particular results. So the selectivity of the definitive drug testing does go well beyond the agents that are detected by the presumptive testing. In sympathomimetic agents, we look at individual designer amphetamines as well as the amphetamines themselves. And there is some ability with immunoassay to identify some of those agents. But when it comes to agents, again, such as pregabalin, gabapentin, tramadol to some extent, mitrogenine agents, cathinones, and the ability to individually detect those is only achieved by definitive testing. There are a whole host of dextromethorphan and dextrorphan, which are seen in our screen routinely in terms of definitive, would be missed by the presumptive testing. For definitive drug analysis, we use the Acuity UPLC iClass interface with a Zevo TQD and have several of those instruments. Sample preparation is an important element of the methodologies that we use in our laboratory. In the era of postmortem toxicology and testing in that particular area, one has matrices that really require a significant cleanup. And we've moved towards the use of automation in liquid handling. And liquid handling really has been something that we've had on our mind for a period of time as an advance that could go on in our practice. We now have significant experience with that in terms of development of the methodologies and the scripts that are needed, and in the use of that, in comparison of that, with the kinds of precisions that we gain where a very experienced analyst is preparing those manually. And we are now convinced that it is an advance in practice to use the automation in terms of the sample preparation. In our definitive drug panel, we have over 20 classes of drugs and over 100 agents that are actually being identified and detected in the methodologies that we use. And the determination of the what to include in that panel is really based upon experience and based upon what is really on our streets today in terms of current agents, both pharmaceutical agents that are out there, as well as illicit agents. And that is a moving target. During the designer fentanyl era, we needed to adapt to the various fentanyl analogs that were present in the on the streets and in use. And it will continue to evolve. It evolved with the cathinone use in terms of the bath salts. So the selection process is not a single panel that will stay there forever. It is an evolving panel based upon on needs for identification of drugs that are actually in use. The benefits of definitive drug analysis are benefits that come to those who are receiving results. The benefits are the expanded knowledge of the number of agents that are present and the education of all of us as to the extent of drug use in our communities. The validation of methods is an essential for each laboratory. we help each other in that particular sense. We have an entire system of communication, which is through our scientific exchange that goes on in meetings, through papers that are presented. And in that scientific exchange comes a great deal of information that's useful to all of us. When we began our definitive one-a-day, really rapid chromatography, we looked towards others who had already developed it, looked at others in terms of what columns were used, what stationary phases were used, and really adapted methodologies that were out there for rapid chromatography. And I think that exchange of information, if I came back to the mission of NTC, that exchange of information where you can actually contact another laboratory, where you can actually go to another laboratory, or where you can go to an instrument vendor who has application, you know, resources, are all important aspects of getting the job done. Our experience with Waters goes across not only scientific collaboration, which has been very productive over the years, but it also goes across delivery of service and the sustaining what is a fundamental tool in our laboratory, which are our instrumentation. That combination of support for instrumentation, that combination of application support, is delivered on a daily basis by our interactions that we have with Waters. The service team, who we need to maintain continuous functionality of our instruments, is a highly responsive service team that is out there. The application team, when you really need to know a question or how to take a functionality you haven't used very well or need to use now, and to be able to call someone to get that information, I've always found that to be available and superb in terms of the individuals who have delivered it, as both on service as well as on application information. I can't say enough for the support that's been provided for our service by a group, and the need for that support in order for us to sustain our mission in terms of service.